This is episode number 20 featuring John Burton. Welcome to the PleinAir Podcast from PleinAir Magazine. I'm your host, Eric Rhoads, publisher and founder of PleinAir Magazine. In the PleinAir Podcast, we dive deeply into the world of outdoor painting called PleinAir painting. For those of you who don't know the term, PleinAir is a French term, which essentially means going outside or being in the open air. Kind of started by the Impressionists, became PleinAir painters. The French pronounce it PleinAir, others pronounce it PleinAir, but no matter what you call it, there's a huge movement of artists around the world going outside to paint, and this show is all about them. This week's podcast is brought to you by the PleinAir Convention next April, which is already over 60% sold out. It's the world's largest PleinAir event. It is my desire to see more people fall in love with PleinAir painting, and you can help by sharing this podcast with your friends, emailing them, telling them on social media, and I hope you'll subscribe so it comes to you every week. And if you have feedback or interview requests, reach me, Eric at PleinAir Magazine, or Eric Rhoads on Facebook. Today's interview is brought to you by PaintingNewZealand.com. Well, we have an incredible guest today. We have John Burton, and we're very honored to have you, John.
Thank you for having me, Eric. I'm glad to be here.
Now, where are you now?
I'm in on the Monterey coast in Carmel, California.
And you're living there now?
Living here now, yes. And it's a beautiful, beautiful place. It's a little foggy today, but beautiful place.
It seems to me, I remember that you were moving to where, Chile or something?
Yeah, to Chile. So yes, I spent last year in South America, down right on the edge of Patagonia, down by farther south than South Africa, down direction of Antarctica. It was an amazing experience.
Well, let's talk about that. I'm very curious about it. What prompted the idea of doing it, and was this designed to be a long term thing or just a short term thing?
Short term. My wife is Chilean. My wife's from Santiago, and I met her here in the United States. And we wanted our kids to be fluent in Spanish, so we moved down for them to be enrolled in regular elementary school, so they would be only speaking Spanish.
What ages are they?
10 and 10, 8 and 6.
So how'd that go? I'm curious about that.
Oh, it was great. There's difficulties. There's always difficulties when you're, you know, for the kids, when you're going to a school where they understand very well, but they had to learn to speak. And, you know, there was months. It was, you know, very similar. I think we had a very similar experience of what it must feel like for a family to be an immigrant family in America. You know, my kids were embarrassed when I spoke Spanish. You know, they would say, "Dad, you know, please don't speak Spanish around our friends. You're embarrassing," because my accent was so horribly gringo. And they had to learn. They had to learn different culture, different ideas. But they were amazing. And I have seen courage in my kids that blows my mind. We had some pretty amazing experience. We went through volcanoes erupting, through revolutions or rebellions. And they were just right there every moment, not worrying about it and just going through it. It was an amazing sight. And I think it really brought our family closer together.
So, well, I have to ask about each of those events because they sound pretty darned exciting. Tell me about the volcano.
Okay. So when we moved down, there was a volcano about maybe 40 miles away that erupted, but it was a small eruption. And, It was very funny. There was, I think, 50 or 51 volcanoes within about 70 miles of our house. And so when the first one erupted, it was so amazing because nobody even talked about it. You know, it was like having a 4.0 earthquake in California. Right. You know, it doesn't even make the news. And for us, it was a huge deal. We're like, I can't believe the volcano's erupting. And everyone's like, oh, you don't have to worry about it. Now, these volcanoes look, maybe if people want to picture it, looks like Mount Fuji. So there's a big white glacier pack on the top. And everyone said, you know, where you are, your main worry is just flooding when that glacier pack floods, or when it melts. Yes. And so we thought nothing of it. I actually grabbed my paints and went up painting and painted the volcano. When it was in the daytime, it was really hard to see the lava. It was more smoke when I was up. But it was a great experience to be able to paint this volcano.
Who was it? Wasn't it Frederick Church or was it Bjerstadt? One of those guys, one of the Hudson River School guys, painted a volcano.
Yeah, you know, it sounds like it could have been either one.
Yeah, I think it was maybe Vesuvius or something like that. It was over in Europe, I believe. We'll have to look that up.
Yeah.
So what was it like painting a volcano? I mean, could you breathe?
Far enough away it didn't affect me. So it was exciting. You know, as plein air painters, we just get such a thrill over everything. You know, I get a big surf, certain clouds in the air. It was just something different that I thought, well, this is unusual. How many people get to paint this? And then, but going further with the volcano, and if anyone wants to look up, the big one was Calbuco. And then it was probably three months later, we hadn't gone up to this one volcano, the one that was erupting earlier, because it was on red alert, and so no one went near it. But it's interesting, after you live in another country and living in South America for 3 months, our American standards for safety had completely changed. And we're like, yeah, let's go up. It's supposed to be beautiful. And this is, I think, a funny story about it. So we go up and we go glamping. Are you familiar with the term glamping, Eric?
Yes, of course.
Uh-huh. Yeah, so glamorous camping, which means instead of bringing your tent, it was a yurt that they had set up. And so we're right at the base of this beautiful volcano because I wanted to go up and paint it and see it. And now we're really close to it, right at the base. And before we go to bed, we're the only people in the campground. And the woman who runs it, who doesn't live on it, came down and told my wife in Spanish, you know, if it does erupt, we will come get you and take you to the evacuation areas. And I told my wife, please tell us where the evacuation areas are, because I'm not waiting for anybody when the volcano erupts. And so she told her, this is where you go. And so I said, because I had heard, like I mentioned earlier, that it's the glaciers melting is the real big issue. And I said, so please ask her, are we moving out of here because of the glacier melt? And she said, oh, no, you're right in the path of the lava river. So if it erupts, we need to get you to higher ground.
Quick.
And you can't believe, like, what it is to go to bed with only canvas, you know, protecting you from outside. Oh, and to add to the story, so we go into the main town for dinner that evening, and it starts erupting. And we can actually see the lava coming out. I have pictures of it, lava shooting out of the top of this volcano. And like I say, it's so interesting how your standards, instead of packing up the car and saying, hey, we are out of here, it was just one more adventure on our trip. And we spent the night, slept, and we heard all night something falling on our yurt, on our tent, and woke up in the morning to being about 2 inches deep in ash. And went, oh my goodness, it erupted last night. And it was about midday, it was still as dark as night. And we were still seeing all this ash fall. And so we thought our volcano erupted. We drove to town and found out this other one, like I said, Calbuco. If you look it up, it looks like Armageddon. This was just an incredible, incredible eruption, where like a Mount St. Helens, where it lost the entire mountain and erupted at night and had lightning storms. It was just, the pictures are amazing. Anyway, it went up. It was about, I don't know, 50 miles from us, and it erupted, put all the ash up 8 miles in the air, and dropped it on the town we were. So we had to evacuate, and the poor people left there. I think they were under 4 feet of ash, and we left after 2 inches of ash and got extremely sick. Had to go to the doctor, the hospital, and things for the ash that we breathed. But so – that's, I think, a very different experience than you normally get to get. Incredible, as being an artist, you see things always half as an artist and looking, wow, okay, this is interesting. So this is what light works looks like through ash, you know, through an ash storm, or, you know, always studying that.
Well, yeah, I get that. I remember one time the Plein Air Painters of America had an event in Catalina, and it was during the fires in San Bernardino or something, and you know, a lot of Southern California was burning, and it was all over there in Catalina. And it was really interesting to see all the paintings reflected that that ash in the air and that and the change of color. It was really an interesting painting experience because it was so different than what everybody was accustomed to.
Right. And I think every time you see something like that, it's building your encyclopedia of knowledge. I mean, you tuck that away, especially if you get a chance to paint it, it really anchors it in your mind to say, oh yeah, okay, that's what that light form looks like.
Okay, so that was one thing you mentioned, volcano. What was the other one you said?
The rebellion?
Oh, the rebellion, that's right.
Yeah. Huh. So I didn't know this before marrying my wife, but Easter Island, you're familiar with Easter Island with the large Moai, the giant statues?
Yeah, that they just recently found out had bodies underneath the ground.
Exactly. So that's, I don't know what they considered a protectorate, but it's Chile owns it. So we went out there and 2 weeks before, we had many experiences like this. This is like the volcano, it's just one after another. But we fly out there, and when we 2 weeks before we leave, there's a rebellion. They're trying to break away from Chile, and so they're pulling people out of their cars with machete. You know, they have machetes and pulling them out. And once again, we're like, well, let's still go. Let's, you know, it's so interesting. Like,
wait. You mean you heard the rebellion was going on, and you didn't cancel your trip?
And we didn't cancel our trip. We still went, and. And it was an incredible experience. It was a once in a lifetime. They were not very happy with the Chileans. And so we were guilty by association, but they were more thrilled when they found out we were from the United States. But there were checkpoints, like to get to the Moai, to get to those statues, you had to go through checkpoints, and they had their revolutionary flag, and they were in army fatigues. They would just, the way you would know them is they only had army fatigues on their pants. And then because it was tropical, so then they'd have whatever they had, the tank top or whatever up top. And we never had any issues. But I know it never turns off, Eric, and I'm sure it's the same with you as an artist. We went through these checkpoints, and I was trying to take pictures, and my wife was like, put your camera away. Because I'm always thinking, oh, this is an incredible painting. When do you get an opportunity to see this?
I have some glasses that have a built-in video camera in them. You can't see the video camera. You need to get one of those.
Yes, exactly. Then you can take pictures while you're driving, and all the things drive your spouses crazy. But but it was interesting. I got to paint those. But you know, if you don't mind, I'd like to talk a little bit about and probably the most incredible experience about going to South America, and that was when we left. Being an artist, I'm able to do that. We're able to change locations as long as I'm somewhere where I can find beauty. You know, it's somewhere I can paint, then I can go. I worked super incredibly hard in advance to supply all my galleries and things. So I knew when I got there, I wanted a few months to get settled before I even thought of sending paintings back or anything like that. And I was so confident. I had prayed that, you know, it was time for a change in my art, a time for a change of growth. And I'd prayed, and I was completely confident that something was going to happen when I was down there. And that was a big reason why I worked so far in advance, because I thought, I don't want any deadlines. I want to think of myself maybe in a long stretch of like a Paul Gauguin going to Tahiti and just going down there and like just painting, just like figure out a direction that excites me. And when I went down, I packed up my studio, all my plein air material that I would need. And I sent it all down, and we got there. So traveling around the world, you know, 16 or so hours to get there, the bottom of the world. That's what they call it, the bottom of the world, or instead of down under for Australia, I think they call it the bottom of the world, Chile. And I get down there, and my paints have all been confiscated. So I can't get my paints out of customs, and I'm going crazy. I've moved my whole family. I've moved my work, and I moved everything to Chile, and I can't paint. And I'm so confident that something is supposed to happen with my painting, and it's driving me crazy. Now, the only paints I did bring was gouache. So I brought all my gouache material. If you're familiar with gouache, it's a, you know, water-based, more opaque medium. But I brought all my gouache. I love painting in gouache if I need to paint in a hurry or just going out to do a quick study. Or if I'm with my family and I just want to get a quick painting in. So I bring my my gouache with me, and my great grandfather was a poet, and he has a great line in one of his poems, and this was completely me. And it said, "When destiny is losing, how's it go? When destiny is losing, she cheats." And it was completely me because I wanted a change, and felt like there was going to be a change. But like everything else, you want it in your terms. And my terms were, yeah, I'll go down there and oil paint. But that's all I have been doing, you know, for years and years and years. And being forced to not have the material I normally work in, I eventually did paint in oils. When I painted the volcano, I painted in oils, and I painted in Easter Island in oils. But for months, I was painting in gouache. And it was amazing because it was forcing me to abstract in a way that I've never abstracted. I was painting quickly. I was just painting shapes in a way I don't think I've ever painted shapes, not being a slave at all to subject matter. And I guess in the way I would say it with this is, I think I'd been taught it. I had tried to do it. But have you ever seen the movie The Matrix?
Yeah.
So you know the scene in The Matrix when he's trying to see The Matrix and he sees all the kids who can bend spoons and do all these things?
Yeah.
And he says to the one kid who's bending the spoons, like, how are you doing that? I can't remember the exact wording. And he goes, I started to be able to bend the spoon when I realized there was no spoon. And I think that was a big part of painting in gouache down there. I stopped seeing trees and I stopped seeing mountains. I stopped seeing people, whatever it was I was painting. I just started to see shapes. And it's followed through. I was interviewed for an article for your outdoor painter online. And one thing I mentioned in there was that I really felt like I'd become a shape maker.
So what is it about gouache that made you go for shapes? Is it because you have trouble defining the exact nature of the brush stroke or something? I've used gouache, but it seems to me that you can use it in a similar way, although it seems to paint drier.
Yeah. That's a great question, Eric. You know, part of it, this is interesting, is I think I hate to even say this because I'm a super positive guy, but part of it was bitterness that, and I didn't mention that, I was so bitter, Eric, that I didn't have my oil paints. I had come around the entire world expecting to oil paint, and now I didn't have my oil paints. And so I think I attacked my gouache with an aggressiveness I have never painted. I hate to say it, but I was painting mad. I would be like, oh my gosh, this scene is so spectacular. And instead of really modeling and thinking about, okay, how does this scene work? I'd be like, no, I'm putting this down and just aggressively. I think that it wasn't so much the medium, because I do think you could use it in different fashion. It was more the aggressiveness. It was the way I put in my strokes. I love the Russians. The Russian art is just blows my mind. And I've always mentioned, I think the Russians, it looks to me like they paint with their fist. You know, some of the...
It's vodka.
Yeah, it could be. Absolutely. I've spent time in Russia, and I know that, you know, in certain places in Russia, you get your change. When you get your change, you get your change with a shot of vodka.
Yeah.
Never had that, but that was a very interesting thing when I was there in the winter. I was like, well, that's an interesting way to get the change of your, you know, when you buy something, like, oh, here's your rubles and here's your shot of vodka.
Well, I think, you know, I remember one of my friends over there told me that in the wintertime, because they go out and they paint in the dead of winter, and it's really cold over there. I was over there in October, and it was just so cold. And they put vodka in their paint because their paint freezes up. It's that cold. So they put the vodka in, and it helps the consistency of the paint. It helps it keep from freezing. But I digress. So back to gouache. And so it's interesting, though, you know, there's an outlook that in all failure comes opportunity, or all failure comes a lesson. And the lesson in this for you, being forced to use gouache, was what?
Was that I was forced to paint in a different way. I was painting. I believe I'm a very fast painter as it is. but I was painting even faster and just saying the, I guess, no, it wasn't only the speed, but I think my aggressiveness, I would add to that, that I knew these gouache paintings were for nobody else but myself. And because I knew that, even though I've taught it in every workshop, every time I speak to someone learning painting, I will over and over say, these are not going in the Louvre. Don't treat them that way. You know, treat them how they should be treated. They're a learning experience. But I think with years and years, even though I try to do that, some of that gets lost in trying to paint for a deadline. And I think that was number one. I painted for myself, which is in the end what I needed to do. I didn't say, oh, this needs, if this finish, like some of them were paintings of a farmer's market. And if I was painting for a gallery or a museum show or something like that, I might have thought, well, this face needs a lot more rendering. Or what's somebody going to think when this person's holding a basket, but I can't tell if it's a basket or a rabbit or who knows what it is. And instead I said, I don't care as long as those shapes are interesting to me.
Yeah, so if you absolutely know beyond the shadow of a doubt that it's not going to be sold, it's not going to go to a gallery, that it's just play, just for your own purposes, then you're willing to take more risk is what I think I hear you saying.
Yeah, that is exactly right. And it's a lesson that I've tried to bring home with me in my oil paints and with everything, is whether it's surface material or the way I lay down my paint, how I design my painting is, you know, it was told to me, this was a great line that was told to me long ago, and it said, you know what, you know, John, you're painting for two people. You're not painting for the masses, you're just painting for two. You're painting for you and the person who collects your artwork, and that person will only collect it if you love it. So in the end, you're only painting for yourself.
I've never heard that.
Yeah, I think it's inspiring to when you get in front of an easel to remind yourself of that. So I am painting for me. Right. I am the artist. I am the one who decides.
Right. And the one person who loves exactly what you just did, whatever that is. So now that you returned and you you're back to oil paints, have you changed the way you paint entirely? And are the outcome of your paintings considerably different?
I think I am starting far more abstractly. I went to the art school I went to the academy, which was completely fantastic. It was my utopia. The academy in San Francisco.
Okay.
And when I was in art school, most of my friends, I'm the only fine artist out of my friends in art school. They all went in to work for movies and for game companies and special effects and things like that. And they were magnificent. I always joke that I thought my classmates went to art school before they went to art school. They were so good. And before that, I went to should I keep the name unnamed?
No.
Be discreet. The school I went. Maybe I shouldn't say.
Arizona. Well, if it's going to be negative and you're going to hurt somebody, yeah, maybe.
It's a major university. They're fine without me. It's Arizona State University, same place Matt Smith went to school. So we had a similar experience. I was a little bit after him. But as far as like abstraction goes, my experience with abstraction was jaded because of my schooling. And in school, I feel sometimes that academia is full only of abstraction. So that doesn't really give you much option, where my comparison with that would be music, is if you wanted to be the next Beethoven, or you wanted to be the next, name anything, Van Halen, Garth Brooks, any style of music, and you went to an art school where they only lit your piano on fire and then screeched nails down the chalkboard, it doesn't teach you. You don't have the opportunity to be any of those. And so I think that, in fact, Matt had a great saying. I hope Matt wouldn't mind if I said it, but Matt Smith, but who was just over my studio just 2 days. He's in town. It was just my studio the other day. And he said, if law or medicine were taught like art, there would be lawsuits. And I think that's a great line. That was my first experience. And I mean, I'm so grateful for you, by the way, Eric, for the PleinAir convention. and for your magazine and for the things that you're doing to give people an education. Because, and that brings me to the next point. I think everyone should be educated in the standard, the basics, the traditional, as you would in music school, and then do whatever you want. Then if you want to be Jimi Hendrix and light your guitar on fire, go do it.
Well, but it gives you freedom.
Gives you freedom.
And, exactly. and the one thing that people don't seem to understand is that the great abstract painters, especially the early ones, those people were all classically trained, and they could render perfectly in most cases. And so when they were able to use that as their base, they were actually able to be more effective. But for some reason along the way, after the armory show in, what was it, 1906 or something, it the second generation of abstract painters didn't learn to draw. And then previous generations, you go all the way to the colleges today where they're teaching, people are getting MFAs in, cutting out papers and sticking them on, doing collages and so on. They're not learning to draw. They're not learning the basics. And I think it's the same thing. It's like music. You've got to learn the keyboard. You've got to learn the notes. And then what you do with it is up to you.
Exactly. And I think by learning that, and that's what I was going to say about abstraction, the place you could go is, I'm not there yet, but since I've come back, your question about what's it been like since I've come back is, I feel like I'm a mad scientist in my studio. I have changed at how I attack my painting. It's like a lunacy in paint of how I can put down colors, how I can put down shapes. For me, painting is communication. And if I need to put a curator next to my painting or a note card next to my painting, it's not successful. It's not that medium. Television has verbal and visual. It's just like the medium right now you and I are speaking on. This is not a visual medium. It's auditory. And so I think that even though I was jaded from school about it, I can see a certain direction where there's abstraction in all traditional art. That's what's so beautiful about it. And I think the more and more I'm seeing in my own work how I can base my traditional painting off an extremely abstract design, it's really helping me with my direction, with where I feel like John Burton needs to go. And I don't know where it will end. It's kind of the beginning. I'm excited to even talk on this podcast even a little about it, because I think I'm going through a transformation that I am not enamored with photorealism, and I'm not enamored with abstraction, but there's beauty in both. And I'll share with you, I am no judge of either. And I'll tell you why this is, and probably any artist can relate to this, is I think I was more judgmental in the past of art that other artists were doing. And I truly have zero now. And I think the reason is because I came to a realization, I can't even judge myself. And I don't know if you have this, Eric. I have a painting. I'll paint a painting I think is the best ever, and I'll pull it out in a week, and I can't even stand to show it to anyone. Or I'll do the opposite, where it's a painting that's horrible, and a week later I'm like, that needs to be framed up and put in a gallery. I love that piece. Do you ever have that?
Oh, it happens to me all the time. I was in I won't mention the name of the gallery because I don't want to create problems, but I was visiting one of the galleries, and they had some of my paintings that I had done many, many years ago that were hanging. And a lady that worked for the gallery was giving me a tour and showing where all my paintings were. And I was cringing. And there's one that I saw it and I thought, oh no, I've got to get that back. I've got to burn it. I've got to do something with it. And the woman says to me, I've been saving my money so I can buy this one personally. I love it so much. And it was really an eye opener for me, because, we all grow, we go to a different place. And then yet, the opposite holds true too, right? So today my assistant was in my office and I have a painting in front of my desk that I did when I first started painting. It's a portrait. And she said to me, who painted that? Because she didn't know I had painted it. She said, that is my favorite painting. And yet it's something I did when I barely knew how to paint. So it's, you just never know how you're going to respond to things. And I looked at it in a completely fresh eyes and thought, you know, not bad. All these years I've been looking at it and thinking, oh, I could do better.
Exactly. So that brings me just what I was saying is if I can't even judge myself, I have no way to judge others. You know, now that's not saying judge others because everyone comes from a different place. That's not to say I can't judge technique as far as, and I've had very classical training. You know, if someone's taking my workshop or if someone comes to me with a question, you know, any art, you know, you put 20 artists together and you all put 20 of their paintings, they all know which one's the best. You know, they can easily quantify that because of technique.
You know, it's interesting though, when you have an artist choice award, it's never the same painting that gets the best painting in the show kind of award. What the artist chooses the best painting is very rarely the one that sells. It's very rarely the one that the consumers pick.
You're exactly right. Cause they're seeing something totally different. You know, you're exactly right. It's, and also the people's choice, you never know. It certainly could be they're the one who lives in town. You know, if I win the people's choice in Carmel, it's cause you know, everyone I know came out and voted for me, you know, rather than what I'm painting. So I
want to get into painting. You've had so many wonderful adventures, and I want to touch on one more of them before we get into painting, and that is that you're doing this series of what's the name of the trail that
the Pioneer Trail, and it's the Mormon Pioneer Trail.
Oh, Pioneer Trail, right? And that so the Pioneer Trail goes from what to from goes upstate from, New York all the way to Utah.
Oh, very good. You know the history. It actually starts in Nauvoo because after New York, the LDS Church was in Nauvoo, Illinois.
Right.
And in Nauvoo, Illinois, there was some killings and some lots of persecution, and so they had to move out quickly in the dead of winter in February and move out, and they eventually moved out of the United States, which was the Utah Territory. And so I have followed my ancestors' footsteps, myself and Brian Mark Taylor and Josh Clare. And all three of us have ancestors who've walked this trail 150 years ago, covered wagons and hand carts and however they could get across. And for the last 4 years, we've been traveling the trail in all different seasons. And we will be having...
Have you been doing it together?
Yeah, together. We'll go out and go to sections of it and, you know, take... You know, Illinois, Nebraska, and take that section, and then we'll go do another section, or we'll say, oh, wow, it looks like there's going to be a snowstorm, so we get out there quickly to try to catch the snow, and or trying to catch in spring or summer. It's been an incredible adventure. Talk about another opportunity for growth, because this is, for anyone, you know, once again, of painters who can appreciate this, the curator calls us a few months before the paintings are getting ready to be due. And we're on a conference call and she says, you know, I just want to let you know that, you know, these paintings don't all have to be large. You know, small paintings work in the show as well. So our reply was great. You know, that's a good opportunity. We'll put different sizes in. So then I ask the question, which was how small is small? And she goes, oh, you can certainly put 30 by 40. And I think she couldn't see us. Luckily, all of our jaws dropped.
Yeah.
And went instantly, as soon as we hung up, called each other. It's like 30 by 40 is small. But what a great opportunity. I mean, these are 5 feet, 6 feet, 8 feet wide. These are gigantic paintings, and many of them. We're each putting 20 paintings in of areas that never get painted. I live in Carmel, and there's books and books about the scenes that I go paint every day. I have painters for the last 100 years that go out. We're painting in areas in Nebraska and Wyoming and Iowa that a lot of people probably don't even, you know, get out of their car to stop and look at. They go by at 80 miles an hour. And there's real beauty. And it is, once again, it's forced. It's forced a lot of design. It's forced Carmel, where I live. You've been out here for the convention. And it paints itself. I mean, even a bad painting of it still looks good. It's all there. There's not a lot of compositional changes you're forced to do because it's just so much natural beauty.
Yep. Yeah, it's incredible.
But with this area, it was a great adventure, really interesting, and the show, I think will be interesting because of the size of the paintings. I don't know a lot of artists right now. I can't even think of any that have a show with that many large paintings in one show.
So a lot of people will hear this now when it's recorded or very shortly after, but a lot of people will probably tune in a year, 2 years, 3 years from now as these things stay in the archives. But so for the benefit of those who hear it early, the show is where and when?
It's in Salt Lake at the LDS History Museum. It will be opening November 17th, 2016, and run to the following summer.
All right. Excellent.
Thank you.
So let's talk about painting.
Super. Yeah.
So I like to make sure that everybody gets a little takeaway or two on these podcasts whenever possible. And, you know, it's so much fun for me because I ask a lot of the same questions and I get a lot of very different answers. It's very clear that everybody approaches things differently. You know, there are similarities in some cases, in some cases, not at all. So what I'd like to do is first off, talk a little bit about composition. What are your theories and thoughts from at the very beginning of a painting?
Okay. From the very beginning, I think it's, once again, like I talked about shape making, it's proportion and the design. For me, it's all about the design. Every painting that I love is really based on that design. And when I say proportion, I think of it like a tropical fish. And what I mean by that is tropical fish are beautiful, not because of their colors, but it's the proportion. God made the perfect proportion of, like, if you ever look at them, study them, like there's only a touch maybe of purple or a touch of a bright yellow. And that really makes the fish. And I know it sounds weird to compare fish with painting, but I think painting is similar to that. And that is, it's all about contrast. You can't, you know, if you know the 80-20 rule, and that's, you know, 80% of one and 20% of the other, which would mean 80% dark, 20% light, or vice versa. 80%, you know, texture, 20% non-texture, or vice versa. 80% warm, 20% cool. And I think when you're working with those ratios, just like the golden section, the Nautilus shell that you're looking for design areas and put it into the thirds, those are elements for possibly the focal point. But I think when you're thinking in design, an 80-20 rule, especially like I also love the American illustrators. When you look at their work, they're really, really great at following that rule. I am not always great at it. No matter how much you try, it's like going out and I don't know if you've done this, Eric, but for me, how many times have I gone out and painted plein air and put the horizon right in the middle of the canvas?
Yeah, well, sometimes you you don't even intend to do it. You know you're not supposed to do it, and you still do it.
Totally.
I did that the other day, and it's like, how did I do that? So I got my paper towel out and moved it. Sometimes it works, surprisingly.
Yes, that's true. If you can work it with other pieces, exactly. Yeah. And
Is there a checklist, you know, like if assuming you were a pilot, right? A pilot has to do certain things before he or she gets in an aircraft and takes off. Do you have a mental checklist before you start painting? You know, is it like, am I going to make this a warm or cool painting? Am I going to do, 80% of this is going to be dark? What kind of thought process do you go through?
You know, that's a great question. I think it's two different things because I think I'm two different painters. And what that would be is in my studio, I'm one kind of painter. And when I'm outside, I'm another. When I'm outside, I'm in fifth gear in a sports car and I'm going as fast as I possibly can. And it's where I gather all my information. So when I'm outside, I'm actually doing a lot more reacting than so to speak, forcing my will on the canvas. I am reacting to color, to shape, and I give very little thought to what I want to do to the painting. Maybe I should more, but for me, it's just a reaction. I look at my plein air pieces as my notes. I love painting outside. I'm a landscape painter because of that, and I am excited every time I go out, no matter where I am, whatever I'm looking at. It's great to do that and to gather those notes. When I come inside, it completely changes. It becomes a chess match. It becomes a big truck going very slow. And that's when I will start thinking about my, like you said, a checklist. Where am I designing? How is it 80-20? I don't, you know, I will also think of concept, think of concepts and then start sharing them with other artists, you know, little sketches or such, and say, what are your thoughts on this? What are your thoughts on that? I recently had Joaquin Sorolla, one of my favorite artists. Joaquin Sorolla's great granddaughter posed in my studio. A friend of mine, Syme from Kauai, had set it up, and she was touring the United States, and she's posed in one of his costumes from the Hispanic Society. And she was sharing, she is writing a book right now about all about his techniques, all the things passed down in her family. One of the things she was showing us was on her phone, she had pictures of it, all these little sketches he did. And it's so interesting now we have our smartphones where we can take a picture of something and send it all over the country. You know, probably like you, I have art friends all over the country where I can send them to Florida, to Utah, to Arizona, to you name it, and say, hey, what are your thoughts? And kind of bounce ideas. Well, I guess he would do the same thing. They would put note cards, and on the note cards, he'd do a quick sketch and then send it out and say, hey, this is what I'm thinking about for the big salon show. What are your thoughts? Oh, speaking of which, Eric, I can only say this once, okay? So this is one time, one chance. She shared the secret to Joaquin Sorolla's painting. Are you ready for this?
I'm ready.
Okay, so she said the most important thing that any painter could learn from Joaquin Sorolla is that
you're such a comedian.
Yes. By the way, when she posed at my studio, Eric, you're not the first. I pulled that on about three different artists. I said she shared this one secret. And then right when I said I was about to share it, I hung up on them. And they called back and said, you. So no, but you know, the one secret really is, I will share the one secret, and everybody knows it. It's practice. It's, you just need to get out. So sorry, I digress. So back to my painting.
Well, listen, a lot of us practice and have practiced a long time, and we're not painting like Sorolla.
Yeah, though, you know, here's, you know, someone shared with me recently, and I am no Sorolla, but they said to me that they have told students, you know, don't take a big canvas outside unless your name is Sorolla. And I have felt in my life the exact opposite. I take 36-48s outside. I take huge canvases outside because of Sorolla. And he was a genius, there's no doubt about it. But because he was a man, because he was human and blessed with you know, as we all are, with God's potential, that I say, okay, well, I might not be Sorolla, but who can I be? You know, what level can I hit? There's a great quote by C.S. Lewis that I love, and it says, let me think, shoot for heaven and you'll get heaven and earth mixed together. Shoot for earth and you'll get neither. And so I think, you know, it's one thing for painters, I think for all painters, is shoot high. You know, when you ask about sharing some ideas with painters, I guess one of the big things I would like to share with anybody listening is when you go in and you appreciate museum work, and I do as well, nobody was born doing that. We were all born with great potential, unlimited potential. And how much can we tap into that? How hard is each one of us willing to work? And there is, for myself, I'm a million times better painter than I had even set my sights for in art school. But I know it came from hard work. It came from getting out in front of you. I mean, and the real source is the subject, you know, getting out and painting from life.
You know, there's a fallacy. And the fallacy is that, you know, some people have the natural gift, and I'm sure some people do have some natural gift. But, you know, if you look at anyone who's accomplished, really highly accomplished in anything, whether it's in business or art or the movies or anything, the people who are at the peak of their game are the people who are working the hardest. They've worked really hard. They really put in the time. They really put in the smart thinking behind it. And they're just constantly rehearsing and practicing, you know, the top people who are the top speakers, you know, the Tony Robbins, he says, you know, in spite of the fact that I've spoken 11,000 times in front of millions and millions of people, I still sit in my hotel room and I practice that speech before I go on stage. That's the mark of a true professional.
Totally. The you know, the 20-year overnight success sort of idea. It's like, where did this guy come from? Well, he's been working at it over and over again. And oh, sorry, go ahead.
10,000 hours, right.
Yeah, 10,000 brush mileage. And I think, you know, another thing is the idea that, you know, the me, the Eric Rhoads, the John Burton, I'm a fluid concept. I am not static. I am not, when someone comes in there and, you know, come into my studio and go, wow, you've gotten a lot better. And I'm always think, well, yeah, I hope so. Yeah. I'm sure working hard at it. Yeah. And when I was in art school, I remember in a semester of art school, I would paint 300 paintings in a semester. And I know people who take my workshops, I will give them a goal and say, paint, and I don't care how big, they can be 4 by 6 inches. They can be 5 by 7, 6 by 8. I always say, paint 100 paintings by this time next year. And I believe you will be a better painter than you ever dreamed of.
Absolutely. There's no question. And when I first started learning plein air painting, I ran into an artist by the name of Kevin Corder. You know Kevin.
Yep.
And I ran into him at art show and I said, how do you do this? How do you learn this? He said, go paint 100 paintings. Limit yourself to 30 minutes each. And after you've done 100, you will have learned so much. So I went out and I did 100 paintings. And so I totally agree with that. I think it's all about brush time. Now, you can escape a lot of that, but you have to have some brush time before you find a mentor. You have to have a certain level of knowledge before that knowledge that they're teaching you will allow you to build upon it.
Right. And, you know, and speaking of mentorship, like for workshops or the plein air convention, for things like that, that I've felt in my life that there is no concept in painting that is rocket science. There is not one thing that when it's explained that you really scratch your head and go, I don't really understand that. The difficulty in painting is there's a million concepts you're thinking and a million decisions during every painting. That's where the difficulty comes. It's not the level of difficulty. It's the amount of information that your mind has to try to chug through every time you paint. And so I think education, learning from others is so fantastic because it can just cut years off your education because you can be going the wrong direction and someone will say, oh, have you ever thought about this? I remember, like, this is a small thing, but a small tip is, you know, painting a mountain in a distance. And, you know, most beginners paint mountains green, you know, because the trees next to me are green. So that mountain,
I know they're green.
Yeah, exactly. It must be green in the distance, even though you're looking through atmosphere and, you know, it's blued. But there is green in it because there's trees back there. So someone once shared with me that, well, what if you mix your blue, because they're blue, with cad red light? Because cad red light has yellow in it, but not enough yellow to force it to go green, but yellow enough to gray your mountain in that direction. And that's just an odd, you know, I'm not huge on tips on color changes because I'm far more about temperature than just like a direct thing. But that was a tip that someone said. I was like, oh, wow, I hadn't even thought that direction. Or I also think so many things can come even from people other than painters. I have a very good friend who's a jet fighter pilot. And I saw the, are you familiar with the Blue Angels or the Thunderbirds?
Yeah.
So I went and saw the Blue Angels and I told him, I said, I've been watching them since a kid and I love them. They're just amazing. And I said, how in the world, those planes don't work like the planes used to work. They look like they jerk instead of like taking a turn. And he said, you know, what's interesting is we stopped the aeronautic companies and aeronautic designers, I should say, stopped thinking about air as air, but started to think about it as water, that it's actually fluid, and it changed the way that planes fly. And to me, I instantly clicked and said, of course, painting atmosphere, I'm looking as if when you look through a pool, it changes in distance if you had goggles underwater. It's the same with the sky. I'm looking, atmosphere is a liquid. It's full of humidity. And I'm looking, and so those sort of things, all things you can kind of tuck away in your art, in your painting. I think that ideas and concepts come from so many different sources. If I could share, you know, one thing I'd love to share with everyone is I think that technique is something everybody needs to learn as a painter. But what do you do when you get technique? Once you do have the ins and outs and understand, by the way, it's a lifelong process, by the way, of learning. Once you get the technique, what are you going to say about it? What are you going to say about a person, a still life, a landscape, whatever it is you're painting? And I would advise to anybody that don't fill your body with bad things and expect good things to come out. And what I mean by that is if you're going to run a marathon, you're not going to eat a hot dog right before. If you want to paint something and paint it, paint something smart, then read from the best books. Listen to the best music. Don't listen and read dribble and expect something good to come out. Go to the best museums. Treat your paintings positively. Don't treat them negatively.
So you're saying that if there is beauty within your soul, if there's purity within your heart and your mind, then that will come out and translate itself within your work.
You said it far better than I did, but yes, exactly. And not only from what you put in your body, but also what I mean by that, like I said, the best plays, the best music, the best of that, but negative. There's a great quote by Harvey Dunn. Unfortunately, I don't know it exactly, but he said, treat your paintings better or they won't treat you better. And when I read that, I was like, oh my gosh, how many times are you the same? I'm like so negative toward my painting. Like, oh, that's the worst. That's the worst. Instead of no, be positive. Look at the good parts, you know, change the bad and look at the good.
Well, I think this is really an interesting point. There's a painter who came to visit me several years ago, probably over a decade. And, you know, I took him out on the lake and he took some photographs and so on. And I showed him some of my work and I was very apologetic, you know, well, I'm just starting this or I haven't learned that or whatever. And he stopped me and he said, Eric, stop making excuses for your paintings. Your paintings are good. They can be better. And so can mine. And he said, we've all been there and you've just, you know, you've got to get your mind in a better place and stop apologizing. And it really kind of kicked me in the face, and it was really an important thing for me to hear, because the one thing I keep trying to tell painters who are going through the process, who are learning, who are maybe young in terms of painting, maybe not young by age, is every painter out there has a pile of panels that are garbage that, you know, any of us would look at and say, I'd never want that. I'd never buy that. We've all done them.
Totally. I have a funny story with that. I did a purge recently of paintings, and 100, 200 paintings I threw away. And being on the California coast, when I threw them away, our garbage dump near my studio is full of seagulls. And so I threw out all these paintings in the garbage dump. And there's a framer, a really high-class framer right next to my studio, paintings of beautiful gold leaf frames. And he came over to my studio that afternoon. Once again, the garbage dump is full of seagulls. And he said, John, you're never going to believe this. They're having an art sale over at the aviary. And he goes, I just picked up a bunch of paintings. Now, when I put them in the garbage dump, I destroy them. So he was just joking. But I always thought that was a funny thing. And he got to see, you know, how much I purge. And speaking of which, Eric, which I think is a great idea, is when you do have too many paintings that you do not care for, get rid of them. Because I'm not who I was, I'm not who I will be, but I have this great potential right now. And if I keep looking at ones that are who I was and ones I don't care about, and they're just sitting around my studio, I believe they do you much more harm than if they were just gone. Now, that's not to say there's certainly plein air sketches that I look through and say, oh, well, this color note was fantastic, and I'd love to use that in a larger piece. But I think there is some value.
See, they have the opposite effect for me. I think every person has their own opinions on these things. But I keep every painting I've ever done other than those that I sold. And I like to be able to have that contrast of time, because to me it's very encouraging to pick up a panel that's, you know, sitting in a box somewhere, and I'll pull them all out every couple of years and I'll look through them, And it gives me so much encouragement to realize how far I've come.
That is a great insight, Eric. Yes, I totally and completely agree with that. I still have my first paintings from art school because for that exact reason. And I like to pull them out in a workshop to tell people, once again, like I said, is when I tell everyone, I wasn't born doing this. I was born with potential. It's my job, and Lord bless me with potential. It's my job to work it out. It's my job to work hard on this. But I'm showing you this painting to see I'm right there. I was with every one of you. And I think when you can show people that, hey, you know what? I'm not way over here. I'm just down the path. I'm leaving breadcrumbs to show you this is how I got there. So I completely agree with that. But I do paint, and I don't know your quantity, Eric, but I do paint easily 300 paintings a year. So I don't put those all out into the market. But at painting so many paintings, there are certainly plenty of dogs and a lot of experimentation and a lot of things that didn't work.
But it's also keeping you very sharp and you're getting a lot of brush time. No, I'm not getting anywhere near that. I wish I were. So as we kind of wind this down, I've got a couple of key questions I like to ask. First off, what's something about you that the history books would never reveal if we're looking up to learn more about you 100 or 200 years from now? What's something that no one would ever know unless you told us?
That I have 11 toes? No, I'm just kidding. I don't have 11 toes for everybody listening. what would they not know? I think that for people listening, if it was far in the future, that, boy, other than what we've just talked about, that's a great question. Let me think for half a second so I just don't shoot off the cuff. Now, this has nothing to do with painting, though.
That's all right.
I think that I would want people to know, and I've alluded to it a few times, but I would probably want people to know about my faith, that I believe I live, that I have great faith in a Heavenly Father in a time that faith was not as popular. And maybe, I don't know, it's different in different states. I've lived in different states, but here in California, it's certainly not as popular. So I probably would be the number one thing I would want someone to know, that in a time when it's not 100 years ago when everybody seemed to have, that I had faith in this time period.
So what is the one thing perhaps that you'd like people to remember about you that is your superhero thing? Like when you have that big red S on your chest, when you're feeling really good about something that you've done, what's your superhero thing?
My superhero thing is definitely being a dad. That's probably much easier. And once again, these aren't art related, but
that's all right. You know, it's all interrelated, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. That coaching my son's soccer team or going to my daughter's, you know, singing recital or whatever. There is no painting that I have ever painted that gives me greater joy or I am more excited about than 5 minutes with any of my kids.
So last two questions. One painter from history, you get 1 hour to ask questions. Who is it and what do you ask?
I would have to go with, gosh, I wish it was two because I...
Okay, I'll, you can have two.
Because I just saw, I love Dean Cornwell's work. So there's so much I would ask Dean Cornwell on design. I would ask him all his ideas. Gosh, I just want to paint with him, of course, and see all his concepts and ideas on design. And so many things of these early illustrators, I think, have been lost. I mean, we live in a great time right now. There are so many opportunities through art schools, through workshops, through plein air convention, through your magazines, through videos, so many ways to learn. When I first went to school, there was three or four schools in the country that were teaching traditionally. And I felt like most of my life has been a detective series of getting that little piece from this artist and that, and here, you know, here a little piece, there a little piece, and trying to group it all together into something that I can use. So I would love to ask Dean Cornwell about design and, of course, paint with them. And so,
Wait, I'm going to interrupt you and just tell you very quickly that there's a hidden gem in Orlando, Florida, that I stumbled upon recently. I went on a business trip. I stayed in a hotel called the Grand Bohemian in downtown Orlando. And up on the fifth floor, the man who owns the hotel is an art collector, and he's got a massive collection of Dean Cornwell paintings.
No way.
Yeah.
Oh, well, I've been actually doing a little bit of consulting with Disney, so I have a reason to go out there. And
there you
go. I look forward to seeing that. Another gem, I'm sure you probably know this, but if anyone is down in Los Angeles at the Los Angeles Library, downtown LA, there is a huge mural of the history of California that is so mind-blowing that you look at this, the design is just beautiful, and even the technique of how he's painting it is so spectacular. So yeah, I love, and for those of you who don't know Dean Cornwell is an American illustrator, was taught by Harvey Dunn, who I referenced earlier, who Harvey Dunn said he was just fantastic, even when he came to him. The other would probably be Sorolla. And I mentioned him earlier as well, Joaquin Sorolla, Spanish painter, for those of you who don't know. But I think with Sorolla, Zorn is similar for me too, Anders Zorn. Is I'd love to see them paint. I'd love to see them especially paint outside. But one thing that really blows my mind and get excited about their work is I look at their work quite often and think they probably wouldn't have left my studio in the state that the paintings, in the level they finish them. That quite often when you go into a museum and you see them, I would have beat those things for another, 2 weeks until they were just too far beat up to even go out. And they have this freshness of laying in the paint and just they're virtuoso. So it makes sense that that's why they're doing it. They just have such a great ability with their brushwork to lay it down correctly and leave it.
Okay. Last question.
Yes.
It's your last day on earth. Everything that you've ever painted has disappeared. There's no reference of anything you've ever done. You're on your deathbed. You have your friends, your family, some painter friends around you, and you're allowed to whisper three truths. They can be truths about life, about painting, about anything. What are those three truths?
First off, remember that everyone you're meeting is going through their own battle that you know nothing about. So be kind. Second, charitable opportunities are perishable. So when you have an opportunity to help somebody else out, help them out. Because if you don't, they will either get help somewhere else or that opportunity will leave and they will not get help. And this is how I live my life. And I've talked to a couple other artists about it. It just came up in conversation lately. And I thought everyone lived this way, especially when you're an artist, because it's just such a privilege to be a painter, is wake up every single day expecting something wonderful to happen.
Good ones. Very good ones. I'll add one to that because your last one reminded me of one that I do, that I've started doing, is I wake up every day and the first thing I do is I open my eyes and I say, thank you for another day. But then I ask, who am I grateful for? And I try to think about who am I grateful for from the day before. And then I try to get on email and or call them and just tell them why I'm grateful for them.
You know, Eric, that is so right. This is the secret of life is gratefulness, isn't it? Because when you get the grateful attitude, everything looks different.
Everything changes.
Everything changes.
Well, John, this was a remarkable interview. Thank you so much for your time today. And what a wonderful life you're living and what a wonderful example you're giving us. And your paintings are wonderful. You're a rock star painter. And we are really honored that you would do this today.
Thank you, Eric. And can I say thank you to you not only for giving me this opportunity, but I want to thank you for everything you're doing in the art world. There is, to me, there's three rock stars in the country, and you're one of them. For what you have done in our time period, for our area, genre of painting is incredible. I'd put you right there, Eric. I'll name the other two in my life. And one is you, one is John Stern at the Irvine Museum, and one is Peter Adams of the California Art Club. I think the selflessness that you have, all three have shown to push art forward in our time period is amazing. I'm very grateful to you. So thank you.
Well, I'm very honored to be mentioned in the same breath with those guys. They're such amazing people. It's very kind of you. Thank you. And once again, great, great interview.
Great. Thank you, Eric.
Well, John Burton has a lot of insights. Thanks again, John. The interview was sponsored by Painting New Zealand. I am taking a publisher's invitational trip. That means we go and play and paint and study painting, but we don't do a workshop. We just paint together for a solid 10 days in this case. There are 50 artists and or spouses going. We're going to paint both islands in New Zealand. We're also going to visit the Weta Workshop, which is the people who made The Hobbit and made Lord of the Rings and some other things. I've got a friend there, Richard Taylor, who's going to give us a tour. He's world famous, and he's going to be there for us. There are only 9 seats left out of the 50, and that was at the time I recorded this, so there may be less available. If you want to go with us, we'd love to have you. PaintingNewZealand.com. Just visit there, PaintingNewZealand.com. Also brought to you by the Plein Air Convention, the world's largest gathering of outdoor painters. And you can be a beginner to come, or you can be a pro. The whole idea is to up your game, to increase your learning, to have a lot of fun. Loads and loads of fun. We keep you busy from morning to night. Marketing classes in the morning and all kinds of classes during the day. And then we even do specialty classes and critiques at night. You can learn more from the world's top artist in a week than a workshop typically. And it's for about the price of a workshop. We also have a pre-convention workshop, which is optional, with Kwong Ho. It's going to be amazing, and that'll sell out fast. And we also have a beginner's basic course, too, for the beginners who want to come, who've never painted, who want to learn the basics before they go out. It'll help you save you probably a year worth of frustration. Some of the featured faculty include Gil Dillinger, James Gurney, Jeremy Lipking, Jill Carver, Linda Tibbetts, Jane Hunt, Chong Huang, Paul Kratter, Lori Putnam, Kathy Anderson, Scott W. Pryor, Kate Starling, Rose Sherling from Holland, Michael Godfrey, Ryan Brown, and many, many, many others. The list is growing. For the price of a single workshop, you get to see lots and lots and lots of artists over the course of 5 days, and you get to go out and paint and practice what you've learned. The current price is $897. There are payment plans. But the price goes up on Black Friday to $9.97, then on Valentine's Day to $11.97, and then goes up to $13.97. So you want to capture it now while some of those lower price seats are still available. And we're already over 60% sold out at the time of this recording. So go to PleinAirConvention.com. Plein Air Movement is hot, which is why Barnes & Noble is selling Plein Air magazine like crazy. As a matter of fact, it's their number one selling representational art magazine. You can get your own subscription at PleinAirMagazine.com. Well, this is always fun for me. Let's do it again sometime. I hope it's fun for you too. Maybe you'll join us next week. We'll see you then. I'm Eric Rhoads, publisher and founder of Plein Air Magazine. Remember, it's a big world out there. Go paint it. We'll see you. Goodbye.